Hello, and a very warm welcome to everyone joining today Mandarin International IVD Forum on Laboratory Management and Detection Technology of Infectious Disease. My name is Tina, Clinical Academic Manager of Mandarin International Marketing Department, and I'll be moderating this webinar. In today's webinar, we will have two outstanding speakers from different countries to share their expertise and experiences on why serology markers are essential and important on doing blood screening or support diagnosis of infectious disease. If you want to know what are the important acceptance criteria that serology tests need to meet when the markers are used in blood testing and infectious disease screening, you will find the answers in the webinar. Okay, let's see the agenda today. Dr. Sian from Indonesia will give the first presentation with the topic of the role of hepatitis B serology markers in the management of hepatitis B infection. During the presentation, Dr. Sian will give us a detailed introduction on the value of HBV serological markers and also the role of the markers in HBV infection management. Dr. Nuqui from Philippines will talk about testing for transfusion transmissible infections in the Philippines, prevalence, platforms, algorithms for HIV, and she will discuss on how to select a reliable methods for HIV detection and will share the testing strategy in the Philippines based on her own experiences. There will be a live Q&A session after both of the two presentations. You will have half an hour to raise your questions and ask our speakers through your microphones. If you want to get a certificate after the webinar, please scan the QR code I will share in this session and take a few minutes to complete the questionnaire. Let me give a brief introduction to our speakers. Dr. Sian Huang, she is the head of Clinical Laboratory Department Premier Jatinegara Hospital, Jakarta, Indonesia. And she is also the chairman of Indonesia Association of Clinical Chemistry. As a chairman, she has been working on IACC-BD collaboration in improving pre-analytical quality program, My Help You campaign. And she is now the leader assessor for ISO 15189 of Indonesian Accreditation Committee. Dr. Sian has extensive expertise on laboratory quality management. We are very happy to have her in this forum. The second presentation will be delivered by Dr. Elizabeth Selena Nuqui. She is the consultant director and chair of the Department of Laboratory Medicine and Pathology at the Medical City, Philippines. And she is the professor of pathology in the College of Medicine, University of the Philippines. She is also the chair of Technical Committee of National Council for Blood Services, Department of Health. Moreover, she is the president of Philippines Blood Coordinating Council and Philippine Society of Oncologists, AST, PCQACL. She is very professional on methods, procedures, and precautions of infectious disease screening. It's a great honor to invite her to attend this forum. Really excellent speakers presenting to you. Let us welcome our first speaker, Dr. Sian. And the topic she will be presenting is the role of hepatitis B serology markers in the management of hepatitis B infection. Welcome.
Thank you. Good day, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Mindray for inviting me to speak in this webinar. My topic today is role of serological markers in the management of hepatitis B virus infection. This is the outlines of my presentation. Despite hepatitis B vaccination program carried out since early 80 and availability of treatment, hepatitis B is still a major public health problems. Hepatitis B affects approximately 2 billion with around 240 million chronic carrier, with 15 of them disease due cirrhosis or hepatocellular carcinoma. Mortality is around 1.4 million a year. Prevalence varies with high prevalence more than 8% in some area in Asia and Africa. High prevalence also found in certain populations like intravenous drug user, homosexual, or HIV patients. Transmission can occur through horizontal routes such as sexual intercourse, bloodborne, or vertical routes such as from mother to the infant. Many people infected with HBV remain unaware of their infection and frequently present with advanced disease and may transmit to others. Lack of effective testing policies, limited facilities, and quality of hepatitis B virus testing might play a role. Hepatitis B prevalence is high in Africa and in Asia. And hepatitis B virus belongs to the Hepatitis virus, which has 10 genotypes. This genotype varies geographically, with the highest prevalence in Asia is the genotype B and C. This genotype are associated with severity of the disease and also response to treatment. Hepatitis B virion is a small, partially double-stranded DNA that has four upper reading frames. Pre-S and S region encodes for the hepatitis B surface antigen. The three small, medium, and large hepatitis B surface antigen. The pre-core and core region encodes for the hepatitis core antigen and hepatitis E antigen. The X region encodes for the transcriptional transactivator protein. And the long one, the polymerase region, overlap all the three other regions and codes for the polymerase reverse transcriptase. There are various hepatitis B virus serological markers. Hepatitis B surface antigen, quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen, hepatitis B E antigen, and also response of the host itself, anti-HBs, anti-HBe, anti-HBc IgM, and also anti-HBc IgG. Hepatitis B surface antigen is the earliest marker of hepatitis B infection, appeared before clinical symptoms and biochemical dysfunction. It persists after the persistent after 6 months suggests chronic hepatitis B infection. Anti-hepatitis B surface antigen is the neutralizing antibody. It can be detectable 6 weeks to 6 months after hepatitis B surface antigen clearance. It is a sign of recovery and or immunity to HBV after natural infection or after vaccination. HBe antigen appears shortly after HBs antigen, correlates with active viral replication and high risk of transmission. Anti-HBe, the detection of anti-HBe is followed by the disappearance of HBe antigen. It denotes decrease of HBV infectivity and remission of the disease. IgM anti-HBc appear at the early stage of clinical disease and disappear within 6 months and indicate acute or recent infection. The IgG anti-HBc appear after IgM and persist for a long time. It's an indicator of natural infection and not elicited by vaccination. It is not a neutralizing antibody, and the presence of IgG anti-HBc it indicates past infection or exposure to HBV. Isolated IgG anti-HBC may indicate occult HBC at HBV infection. The benefit of serological markers are diagnosis or screening of suspected high-risk or contact-positive individuals. Usually, the marker used is HBs antigen, but some countries use also combination of HBs antigen with anti-HBs, anti-HBs, and anti-HB core. It can used to clarify natural history, whether it's acute or chronic HBV infection. Used for evaluating disease activity, monitor antiviral treatment, and also monitor immunity and vaccination or past infection or of HBV. There are two types of natural cause of hepatitis B virus infection. First is the acute HBV infection. In the acute form of HBV infection, HBs antigen appear first, followed by the HBe antigen. When the HBs antigen disappear within 6 months, anti-HBs will appear. And when the anti-HBe appear, the anti-HBe antigen will disappear. The IgM anti-HB core will appear soon after, early in the disease course, but it will disappear in 6 months. But the IgG anti-HB core will persist for a long time. So in the acute phase, we can find the HBs antigen, HBe antigen, and IgM anti-HB core. There are two types of chronic HBV infection. One is the HBe antigen positive, and the second one is with the HBe antigen negative. In the HBe antigen positive, the HBe antigen will persist with the HBs antigen, and there is no anti-HBe appearing. Here we can find the HBs antigen, HBN antigen, and total anti-HB core. But with the HBe antigen negative, there is a seroconversion of HBe antigen disappearing and the anti-HBe detection. So in the HBe antigen negative chronic HBV infection, we can find that we can find HBs antigen, total anti-HBC, and anti-HBe. Screening of HBV infection is recommended in many occasions in people not vaccinated, especially in the high endemic region, and also for a patient who is high risk of getting infected by HBV, such as healthcare worker or contact positive for with HBV patient, hemodialysis patient, homosexual patient, HIV patient, and also for patient with high risk of transmitting disease like in pregnancy, who can transmit the disease to the infant, and also in blood or organ donors. And also screening HBV infection is indicated in people for detecting the risk of HBV infection reactivation in patients receiving immunotherapy, immunosuppressive therapy. Combination of markers for screening HBV infection will increase the information that can be get. HBs positive, antigen positive with anti-HB core positive without anti-HBs indicate chronic hepatitis B infection. The patient should get an additional testing like HBV, hepatitis B, E antigen, and also further management. But if HBs antigen is negative and both anti-HB core and anti-HBs is positive, it indicates of past HBV infection. No further management is needed unless the patient is immunocompromised or undergoing chemotherapy or immunosuppressive therapy. If the HBs antigen is negative, but only an anti-HB core is positive without anti-HBs, it means past HBV infection, or it can be false positive anti-HB core. But this pattern can also happen in the window period where the anti-HBs has not appeared, or if there is a false negative hepatitis B surface antigen when we use a non-sensitive assay, or if there is a mutation in the pre-S or S region so that the assay cannot detect the hepatitis B surface antigen. In this case, hepatitis B DNA is needed if the patient is immunocompromised. If only anti-HBs is positive and hepatitis B surface antigen and anti-HB core is negative, then it means the patient is immune. This is usually due to vaccination. And if all the markers are negative, it means that the patient is uninfected and not immune, but the patient needs vaccination. Scheiblauer, in evaluation of 70 hepatitis B virus surface antigen assay, found that 23 HBs antigen enzyme immunoassay kit has analytical sensitivity less than 0.13 IU per ml. 20 kits were in the sensitivity range of 0.13 to 1 IU per ml. But the rest, 8 immunoassay and also 19 rapid assay, had analytical sensitivity 1 to more than 4 IU per ml. This kit shows genotype and mutant-dependent sensitivity also. In 57 test kits, specificity was 99.5%, but the other 13 kits was specificity was 96 to 99%. In conclusion, laboratories should therefore be aware of the analytical sensitivity for HBs antigen assay and check for the relevant HBV variants circulating in the relevant population. Pronier et al. Found that more sensitive hepatitis B surface antigen assay can help in early detection, shortening window period, less of occult hepatitis B infection, and better determination of functional cure. Also, it can help in better detection of patient at risk of reactivation in immunosuppressive treatment. WHO issued the performance acceptance criteria for HBs antigen. For screening of blood donation and testing of asymptomatic and symptomatic individuals for diagnostic purpose, the enzyme immunoassay should have low detection limit less than 0.13, and sensitivity 100%, specificity more than 98%. But for the rapid diagnostic test, the low detection limit should be less than 0.13 IU per ml, but sensitivity more than 99% and specificity more than 98%. But if only for testing of asymptomatic and symptomatic individual for diagnostic purposes, the lower limit of detection is larger, is less than 4 IU per ml, with the same sensitivity and specificity for enzyme immunoassay and rapid diagnostic tests. Sherry Blower found also that with using more sensitive HPS antigen assay, delay at analytic sensitivity of 1 IU per ml and 4 IU per ml are 11.3 and 16.6 days compared to blood screening standard of 0.05 IU per ml. And the total delay following HBV infection is 22.6 to 33.2 days. So by using more sensitive HPS antigen assay, we can shorten the detection of shorten the infectivity and also have more early detection of HBV infection. Emini et al. In diagnostic accuracy meta-analysis found that rapid diagnostic test sensitivity compared to ELISA is 90%, but lower if compared to chemiluminescent assay. Sensitivity of hepatitis B surface antigen assay is also lower in patients with positive HIV. It is said that maybe the immune complex from the hyperglobulinemia in HIV may play a role. And also, HIV positive patients treated with nucleotide analog can cause mutation in the hepatitis B surface antigen and in the pre-S and S region and cause HBs antigen not detected. Here we see in HIV positive patient, both with RDT and EIA, the sensitivity is lower. The HIV negative in HIV negative is it's higher in both assay. Increased sensitivity of hepatitis B surface antigen have been reported also with increased false positive in weekly reactive result. And so confirmatory testing might be needed. Chow et al. In 144 HBs antigen specimen tested with eCLIA found that 32% specimen with cutoff index 1 to 4, this is the low cutoff index, were unconfirmed with confirmatory testing. This is also found and reported by Purnamawati in 80 HPS positive tested with enzyme-linked fluorescent assay. The author found that 36.2% is unconfirmed with neutralization assay. Some specimen with high cutoff index more than 4.0 has 100% specificity. Fletcher et al. Also found among 615 HBs antigen positive sample, 7% was unconfirmed. 7% low reactive result was unconfirmed with in-house HBs antigen neutralizing test. In low prevalence settings, less than 0.54%, confirmation of hepatitis B surface antigen with a neutralizing step or second and different RDT HBs antigen was recommended by WHO to reduce false positive rate. Hepatitis B virus has mutation rates similar to RNA virus. Because of the overlap open reading frame regions, mutation in one region can cause mutation in other region. Mutation occurs during viral replication itself, and also can be induced by external pressures such as host defense, vaccination, and antiviral treatment. Hepatitis B viral mutation could cause decreased sensitivity and cause undetected infection, hepatitis B surface antigen escape mutant, and also acute hepatitis B infection. And it can also cause immune escape, cause hepatitis B vaccination breakthrough infection. Mutation can also cause antiviral resistance. Mutation in pre-S and S region can cause atypical serological finding, such the combination of negative hepatitis B surface antigen with positive hepatitis B E antigen, combination of negative hepatitis surface antigen with positive anti-HBsAg core, negative HBs antigen with positive HBV DNA, and also positive both positive HBs antigen and anti-HBs. And can cause underdetection of hepatitis B infection. Mutation in pre-core and core can cause undetected marker and cause negative HBV antigen or negative anti-HBV core. Mutation in X region can cause reduced expression of HBs antigen and HBV antigen. Here we see that the core gene mutation in the core gene will cause mutation in the HBV core antigen and HBV antigen. And in the pre-S and S gene, cause mutation in the hepatitis B surface antigen. And because the polymerase gene is overlap the other region, mutation in the polymerase gene or in the mutation in the other gene can cause mutation in the other gene also. Some of the atypical serological profile of hepatitis that can be found are pre-S and in the pre-S and S mutant, we can find negative hepatitis B surface antigen and negative anti-HBs with positive anti-HBV core. And we can also find escape mutant with the pre-S and S mutant, where we can find negative HBs antigen, but we have anti-HBs and anti-HBV core. In the pre-core and core mutant, we can find positive hepatitis B surface antigen, but we have only HBV antigen positive without anti-HBV core because the hepatitis B core antigen was a variant, and we can find negative hepatitis B antigen because of the mutation caused various variant in the hepatitis B E antigen. Here we can find the hepatitis B surface antigen positive, hepatitis B E antigen negative, but anti-HBV core positive. A study in 6 hepatitis B surface antigen assay found that different sensitivity to mutant in different assay. In the first assay, here we see that there is the mutant and the native mutant is undetected, but the third and the fourth assay can detect all the mutant, but the fifth and the sixth assay cannot detect both the recombinant mutant and the native mutant. So we have to know what mutant is circulating in our region. Serological marker is also useful in evaluating clinical phases in infection. For chronic HBV infection, we can use it is a HBV marker that is used for chronic HBV infection are SBS antigen, SBE antigen, anti-SBE, and HBV DNA. And also combined with the biochemical marker alanine transferase, and also for fibrosis marker using the elastography or biochemical biomarkers like the M2BPGI or the liver biopsy. Chronic infection can be classified by hepatitis E antigen. There are hepatitis E antigen positive and hepatitis E antigen negative. The hepatitis E antigen positive can further classify into the chronic infection, or formally called the immune tolerance, and chronic hepatitis, formally called the immune reactive hepatitis E antigen positive. In hepatitis E antigen positive, usually the SBS antigen and HBV DNA is high. But in chronic infection, the liver disease is usually minimal or normal. But in chronic hepatitis, the liver disease is usually moderate or severe with increased ALT. In hepatitis E antigen negative, it is also classified further to chronic infection and chronic hepatitis. Chronic infection formerly is called inactive carrier, and chronic hepatitis formerly is called hepatitis E antigen negative chronic hepatitis. Usually the hepatitis B surface antigen and HBV DNA is low. The differentiation between chronic infection and chronic hepatitis is the severity of the disease. In chronic infection, usually it's normal, but in chronic hepatitis, there is an elevation of ALT and moderate liver injury, moderate or severe liver injury. Combination marker for screening HBV antigen can help in classifying stages of hepatitis B infection, whether it's acute hepatitis B, recovered chronic hepatitis B, inactive carrier, occult hepatitis B, or post-vaccination. Serological markers can also help in the management of hepatitis B infection. Treatment of hepatitis B infection usually use SBV DNA, ALT level, and severity of liver disease indicated by the fibroscan, elastography, or by biochemical marker, or by biopsy. Usually, if the severity of the disease is high, then the antiviral treatment will be started. In SBS negative patient, treatment will be also with anti-SBCOR positive, and in SBS antigen negative patient with anti-SBCOR positive, treatment also will be initiated if there is a risk of reactivation of hepatitis B virus infection. Serological marker also helpful in monitoring treatment. The target of treatment is the HBV DNA less than 2000 IU per ml with negative HBS antigen, normal ALT, and seroconversion of HBE antigen to anti-HBE. And in inactive carrier, patients should be monitored with ALT every 3 months in the first year, and also every 6 to 12 months afterwards. Hepatitis B, E antigens should be monitored every 3, 6 to 12 months if treated by pegylated interferon alpha, and 6 to 12 months after the treatment. Monitoring of hepatitis B surface antigens should also be checked at 12 months interval, and if patient is seroconverted, and it should be checked, anti-hepatitis B surface antibody should also be checked. If patients are not treated, then the patient should also be monitored. Patient with hepatitis B antigen positive who are not be treated should be monitored with ALT, SBV DNA every 3 to 6 months, and SBE antigen every 6 to 12 months. And in SBE antigen negative, if it's not treated because the SBV DNA is less than 2000, then it should be monitored with ALT and SBV DNA every 3 to 6 months, and SBSAG every year. Quantitative HBsAg is getting more popular because it can be done with our immunoassay instrument using the chemiluminescent method. Quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen reflects the transcriptional activity of intrahepatic HBV covalently closed circular DNA, or commonly called CCC DNA, an indicator of viral protein synthesis. Quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen also correlates with HBV DNA, and it has potential in differentiating HBV infection phases because it can quantitative HBs antigen less than 1,000 can detect. Can help in detecting hepatitis B antigen negative chronic infection in certain genotype. It can help also in monitoring response to pegylated interferon alpha or nucleoside analog treatment, and also guiding decision on treatment duration. It can help determining prognosis of chronic hepatitis B infection because higher quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen has been associated with progression to cirrhosis and hepatocarcinoma, cellular carcinoma. Hepatitis B surface antigen quantitative is also a potential marker for management of chronic hepatitis B. Low serum hepatitis B surface antigen measured 1 year after hepatitis B antigen seroconversion may predict subsequent hepatitis B surface antigen loss in hepatitis B genotype B or C. In treatment with interferon alpha, hepatitis B antigen positive chronic cases, quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen can be used in monitoring whether the treatment should be stopped or not. Also in hepatitis B antigen negative chronic hepatitis B genotype D, hepatitis antigen level can also be used to monitor the treatment of interferon alpha. If there is any decline in week 12, the treatment can be continued, but if there is no decline, then the patient should be tested with HBV DNA. If more than 2 logs decline, the treatment can be continued. Less than 2 logs decline, the treatment should be stopped. It is different with the HBe antigen positive chronic hepatitis B, where they use the more than 20,000 IU per ml to decide whether to stop or not. Sang et al. Also found in their study that quantitative HBs antigen less than 8 IU per ml has 100% negative predictive value, and hepatitis B, quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen less than 20 IU per ml has more than 95% negative predictive value to predict HBV antigen more than 2000 IU per ml. I think that's the end of my presentation. In summary, hepatitis B infection is still a major public health problem. Lack of effective testing policy, limited facility and quality for hepatitis B virus assay might play a role. Using sensitive method could improve early detection of HBV infection and help in the better classification and management of patients. HBV mutation can give misleading atypical serological pattern and has been associated with reduced sensitivity. Serological HBV markers combined with ALT, HBV DNA, and fibrosis marker are also important in the management of patients with chronic hepatitis B. Quantitative HBsAg might be helpful in differentiating HBV infection phases, monitoring response to treatment, and also detecting the prognosis of the infection. Thank you for listening, and I hope this presentation is helpful in our clinic laboratory practice daily. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sian. That was an excellent presentation on the laboratory quality management of HBV screening. We are going to move on to the next presentation, which will be delivered by Dr. Nuqui. And the topic is testing transfusion transmissible infections in the Philippines, prevalence platforms, and algorithms for HIV. Welcome.
Good afternoon. Our session this afternoon will be on transfusion transmissible infections and screening algorithms with a focus on HIV. The outline of this lecture on HIV, this will cover perspectives from a pathologist, clinical pathologist, who's also a blood banker, and consultant for the National Blood Services Program. We shall discuss the importance of quality performance, selection of HIV tests. We shall share with you some of our updates on HIV in the Philippines, with particular reference to the National Reference Laboratory for Transfusion Transmissible Infections. We shall describe some of the algorithms we use for transfusion transmissible infections. In particular, we shall give you RITM data. That's the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine, which is our NRL for TTIs. We shall discuss with you some of the test system specifications which serve as our guides. These are largely taken from the World Health Organization. We have a few words on the systems that we use in the Philippines for HIV testing, including ELISA, chemiluminescence assay, and nucleic acid testing. We shall discuss briefly some important topics having to do with this selection process, and that is called fit for purpose and intended use. Finally, we'll talk to you a little bit about analytical and clinical studies. When we talk about quality services from the laboratory or blood bank, and or ideal of effective laboratory results. Much of this proceeds from the National Reference Laboratory or the National Reference Authority, because that is the agency in charge with pre-market assessment of in vitro diagnostics. That includes all our kits and reagents for HIV testing. So we're talking about first, quality, safety, and performance is assessed. Then for laboratory testing itself, which is the analytic process, we have to follow quality management systems or QMS in the implementation. And finally, for post-market surveillance of in vitro diagnostics, again, the National Reference Laboratory will take a major role in this because of proactive and passive reporting based on their performance on ECWAS or NECWAS, National External Quality Assurance Schemes. The reason why we're discussing safety of blood products is because we are concerned with window period donations or donations where the HIV may not be detected because the donor is either in the eclipse period or in the window period. And excuse me, these are just days following HIV exposure, and that's up to 10 days that is defined as eclipse. And then depending on the sensitivity of either the antigen or antibody assay, the window periods are defined. The eclipse phase is a short interval, typically 10 to 12 days in duration, following HIV acquisition in which a person is infected with HIV, but HIV RNA has not reached detectable levels. The eclipse phase is often also defined as the initial interval after HIV infection when no laboratory markers are consistently detectable. So you will understand that during this period, it's very dangerous for a donor to be giving blood because he's actually harboring HIV, and we in the blood bank are unable to detect it. On the other hand, the serologic window period is defined during the latter part of the serologic window period. There are direct viral tests such as HIV P24 antigen or HIV RNA or HIV P24 antigen assays, which can detect HIV. The duration of the window period depends on the sensitivity of the antibody assay used. For HIV RNA tests, approximately 10 days after initial HIV acquisition, plasma HIV RNA levels become detectable. And generally, these levels will rapidly ramp up to very high levels, typically peaking above 200,000 copies per ml. You understand then that during the eclipse period, when HIV is already in the donor because he has been exposed or has actually been infected, even though he's undetectable, that is when these RNA levels are rapidly ramping up to very high levels. So he's then very infectious. Now just a bit of a review of our HIV cases in the Philippines. The Philippines has a dubious distinction, I'm sorry to say, of being one of a few countries where HIV is still increasing in prevalence. The average number of people newly diagnosed with HIV per day as early as 2011 only numbered 6. But as you can see in this chart, it has rapidly increased to 16 in 2014, 25 in 2016, which is practically five times that number from in a period of 5 years, and then 35 new cases in 2019. According to reports, it was only 22 in 2020. However, that has to be taken with a grain of salt because during the pandemic, which started in March of 2020, our data gathering and reporting was less than adequate. So that might be actually underreporting in 2020. The HIV/AIDS and ART Registry of the Philippines no longer reports blood statistics from the transfusion transmissible infections of the National Reference Laboratory. They've stopped doing that. So in summary, the HIV cases in the Philippines are still increasing. And as you can see, in 2021, just from January to August, we had 33 new cases diagnosed. And the total reported cases for August 2021 alone was 878. These were predominantly males with advanced infection in 110. For that month, there were a total of 142 deaths. And you can see from the bar graph below that most of these patients, 40% or close to 50%, were in the age range of 15 to 49. As far as geographic distribution by region of residence among newly diagnosed, the National Capital Region, which is here in the dark orange, numbered 234 cases during that month, representing 27% of our newly diagnosed HIV cases. Following that, colored orange was Region 4A, which includes the Calabar-Barzon area, which is a little south of Manila, NCR, with 14%. And then Region 6, which is in the Visayas region, Central Visayas, with 9%, and 10, Region 10, which is in Mindanao, with 9%. So those are the four top regions among the newly diagnosed HIV cases. In general, as I said, we follow WHO guidelines and recommendations. By law, screening of all blood donations is mandatory, according to WHO, for the following infections, including HIV-1, HIV-2, hepatitis B, surface antigen, hepatitis C, either a combination of antigen antibody or HCV antibodies, and syphilis, which is the fourth in the WHO list, screening for specific treponemal antibodies. In addition, in the Philippines, by law, we also screen for malaria. All blood donations should be screened for at least one suitable serological marker for each of these four, in our case, five infections. And screening for additional markers, in our case, again, malaria, will depend on residual risk, logistics, and the level of resources. Our testing strategy or algorithms in the Philippines, considering all these mandatory tests that you see on the right side of your screen, HIV antigen antibody or anti-HIV, hepatitis B surface antigen, ACV, anti-treponema pallidum, and malaria, it can be antigen or antibody. As a note, syphilis reactive results are actually no longer referred to the RITM, which is our National Reference Lab for Transfusion Transmissible Infections. And due to logistics and supply concerns, our HBsAg reactive samples, which used to be all referred to RITM, also above, if above cutoff points, are no longer referred. Looking at 2020 confirmatory test results, we see that HIV, which is the bottom bar, was confirmed positive in more than 94% of cases referred. And some samples, however, were rejected for various reasons, such as inadequate sample or problems with identification and labeling. The NRL describes the distribution of TTIs among blood donors according to sex. As we said, most of our donors are male. So in this table, you see that close to 89% of them, or 3,054, are in fact males, whereas only 11% were females. And in the HIV column that you see, 98.3% of these positive donations were actually male. And according to age, again, I think this is true of the rest of the world, because the peak ages where HIV is reported are the ages between 21 to 40. And indeed, in the Philippines, 60% roughly of our donors who turned out to be positive were in the age group of 21 to 30 years. And among blood donors, according to frequency, again, looking at 2020, our new donors accounted for more than half of the positive donations, reactive donations with TTIs. And as far as HIV is concerned, close to 53%, which is almost the same, were found in new donors. The repeat donors, somewhat less, 47%, were found to be repeat donors among the HIV reactive blood donors in 2020. This is a bit of a surprise, because usually we are taught that repeat donors or regular donors are actually safer donors. But in these statistics, we find that they're almost equal in distribution among first-time donors or new donors and repeat donors. As far as type of donation in 2020, again, we found the most number of donations which were positive or reactive for HIV among the mobile blood donations. That's about 39 or 40% in the case of HIV, which is the highest category. The other category of donation were directed donations, replacement donations, and walk-in donations. Again, this is a bit of a surprise, because generally, mobile blood donations are conducted among individuals, you know, whether companies or schools or church groups, who are truly volunteer donors. But this probably points out a problem among test-seeking behavior among so-called volunteer donors, because they will go to a mobile blood donation facility, sometimes really to be tested to know their HIV status without having to pay for the tests. This is a little bit older, this data from 2013, also from the TTI RITM, but I think reflective of Asia-Pacific figures. We can see here that roughly one-third of blood donations were discarded for the reason of transfusion transmissible infections. It is important to discuss conditions which we must fulfill to ensure quality of blood screening. One, only test systems designed and validated for blood donor screening should be used. All test systems should be validated by the manufacturer. Before implementing a test system for routine analysis, the laboratory should validate that the manufacturer's specifications are met and are consistently maintained. These are very important conditions or criteria in our selection of blood screening platforms. The test system specifications that need to be established and are met by the manufacturer include specificity, sensitivity, accuracy, repeatability or reproducibility, known interferences such as hemolysis and leukemia, lower and upper limits of detection, and the condition or specification that this system must be approved for blood screening by the National Regulatory Authority. In our case, that is the NRL. And we follow, as I described, the WHO technical specifications, which means, for instance, that for analytical sensitivity and specificity, for unselected donors, including first-time donors, for HIV, anti-HIV 1 and 2, we need to test that system on 5,000 donors. And as far as diagnostic sensitivity, we need to do at least 20 panels to demonstrate seroconversion or low titer HIV. This is a rerun of the same table to highlight the possible presence of potentially cross-reacting blood specimens and also the differences between hospitalized patients and unselected donors, because you have a more specific test establishing the diagnosis in patients, you only need to run the system against 200 patients. As we said before, all methods require certain specifications according to WHO criteria, whether it's enzyme immunoassay or chemiluminescence assay, the tests for anti-HIV 1 and 2 should demonstrate a sensitivity of 99% and specificity of equal to or greater than 99.8%. It should be registered in the Ministry of Health, evaluated by the National Regulatory Agency, and staff for the blood transfusion service should all be trained in these tests for HIV. As far as confirmatory test results, again in 2020, which were tested in the National Reference Laboratory, again, we look at HIV at the bottom bar, which represents roughly 95% of confirmatory tests, establishing the positivity of these referred samples. Just a mention about syphilis and malaria, although syphilis is no longer referred, and also malaria is now, although it is referred for confirmatory testing, is really covered by another national reference lab, which is the one on malaria, which is also based in the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine. A very important question in our selection is this: is the test fit for purpose? Whenever we try and consider a test for implementation or for setting up in our laboratories, we have to ask ourselves if the test is fit for purpose. In other words, what is the purpose of the test? And is the test actually fulfilling that purpose? And an important note or attention should be paid to a product insert describing intended use. Usually, this is the first information provided, and it includes a brief statement of the type of assay, what it can detect, the sample type to be used, and the type of testing that the kit is appropriate for. In other words, in this statement of intended use, the manufacturer states the purpose the kit has been designed for, and it should be used just specifically for that purpose and not for any other. So any other purpose or use would be described as off-label. This is very important in the selection of test kits for HIV, for instance, because we have to be sure that that particular test system or reagent system is intended for the screening of blood for TTIs or for HIV. The conditions or the specifications for diagnoses are very different from the ones for screening. You have to be a very sensitive test for screening, because that will then eliminate any possibility of an infection or contamination. Whereas a test for diagnosis has to be very specific, because it's meant to establish or rule in the presence of disease. So further to the intended use statement, we need to know that specimen type, as I said, so it's either serum, plasma, whole blood, sputum, or urine. It's best to know, pay attention to the testing population, whether they're symptomatic individuals, neonates, or pregnant women. We need to know the intended user who should perform these tests or who should employ these kits. And that's the laboratory technician or medical technologist or the healthcare worker or even a lay person, which is what happens sometimes for the rapid HIV diagnostic tests. Of course, the intended setting is also important. And most of the time, our own setting is the laboratory or blood bank. But once in a while, we do have point of care, and there are commercially available tests that are meant to be used at home. Why do we pay attention to all the product information? It's because it's important in our risk analysis and control. We have to summarize the report of risks identified, the risk to the patient from an incorrect result, which means that you might be passing or rendering a safe a product which is not actually safe, and therefore may be the source of infection for the recipient. There are indirect risks from product-associated hazards. For example, instability that leads to incorrect results. In the blood bank, as you know, we have very strict temperature specifications for either refrigeration or freezing, depending on the product. There are user-related hazards that should be addressed through proper training. And we do have a special certification for our medical technologists to be able to perform HIV testing. And they have to enroll in a training course that's administered by the National Reference Lab for a duration of 1 week or 2 weeks. And there are also refresher courses after a period or an interval of about 3 years that the certificate has to be renewed. There are, of course, also production-related risks and that includes some of the transit problems with the cold chain, transport and distribution, as well as production. So we need to describe also risk reduction measures, which means that we need to be monitoring temperature, we need to be monitoring skills of medical technologists or staff, and we need to restrict the performance of these tests to trained staff who have been certified by the NRL. And lastly, we should really ideally have evidence of a favorable risk-benefit ratio. So summarizing these performance characteristics for serology, we need to look at clinical sensitivity, that is the numbers or proportion of clinical cases which can be detected using this test. We have to use clinical specificity, which means it can rule out or establish a diagnosis in these cases. We looked also at analytical sensitivity, possible cross-reactivity, reproducibility, which includes inter-reader variability, and a decision about invalid run rates. On the molecular side, which is increasingly being used in our country for nucleic acid testing to screen blood donations, we need again to look at clinical sensitivity and specificity, as well as linearity, limit of detection, reproducibility, which includes within assay, between assays and instruments, as well as robustness, and again, invalid run rate. In terms of internal specifications, it is best to have an adequate throughput, especially if your blood bank is processing many samples or many donors. So ideally, at least more than 100 samples per hour. We need to provide enclosed automated testing, also to minimize contamination, to eliminate human errors, and to allow significant walkaway times due to large input capacity, so that your medical technologists or blood bank technologists can actually be doing other things in the blood bank services. More on internal specifications. We need to ensure rapid turnaround times because it is vital for, especially for blood needs, for operating room use, operating theater use, and emergency cases, that we have rapid turnaround times. They should be easy to use. There should be good technical and logistic support to the equipment, the automated system that we use, and a system of quality control, reporting and an assurance scheme. Ideally, of course, it should be linked to the IT or information technology and laboratory information system. In terms of logistics specifications, we need to have a good vendor. So we need to choose those vendors who are reliable and whose products are validated, as we described. We need to look at price and procurement system, availability and reliability of the supply of test kits and reagents. This is, of course, a problem, has been a problem for the past 2 years because of the pandemic, because of the disruption of the supply chain and some problems with availability and the deliveries that we actually receive in the hospital to render blood bank services. Finally, we have to look at shelf life of the test kits and reagents. We don't want our reagents to be expiring on us before they are used, because these are generally quite expensive reagents. More on logistics, infrastructure is very important. And again, from the perspective of a consultant for the blood services, we need to see that there are controlled storage conditions and uninterrupted power supply. You know, in the Philippines, there are some problems with power generation and brownouts and even blackouts in certain times of the year, like summer, when there's a large demand for air conditioning and office work, or even domestic use of air conditioning. There should be technical support for troubleshooting, and equipment maintenance, servicing, and repair should actually be very regular, very religious, and properly documented. Going to analytical studies, we need to point out the difference between precision and accuracy. And the diagrams below show you the example of precision. On the left side, you see the behavior of a system that is precise, that is hitting the same value on your target repeatedly. Okay, so it's precise. But it is a little bit farther, it's two rings away from the target, so it's not very accurate. On the right-hand side, you see a target which shows you very good accuracy, since it's quite close to the target at the center, and also around the first ring of the target. So it's accurate, but not necessarily precise, because those determinations or variates are distributed around that circle. When we speak of accuracy, we talk about the trueness of measurement. So for quantitative and qualitative assays, when reference standard or method is available, and ideally it should be, that is then the basis of comparison for accuracy. Precision we have described in the graph below, the diagram below, and that will determine your within run variation, whereas reproducibility will establish variability between runs, between days, between reagent lots, between users and instruments, and even sites. Analytical studies or analytical specificity is important to determine interference and possible cross-reactivity, as well as studies that should include the substance type, concentration, specimen type, study design that includes appropriate potential interfering substances, so that you're able to demonstrate whether in fact it affects your results, either upward or downward, or interferes with it. So substances used for treatment or use, substances ingested by the patient, substances added to the specimens, substances encountered in specific specimens, and specimens reactive for other medical conditions. So these are all possible or potential causes of interference. For analytical sensitivity, we actually ideally should provide description of specimen type, analyte levels, and how levels were established, the number of replicates tested at each concentration, the calculation used to determine sensitivity, and for a quantitative assay, there are set limits that we must define, the limit of blank, the limit of detection, which is the lowest concentration that can be detected by the system, and the limit of quantification, which shows you the range that it can report values. Why do we want or desire a robust test? Because we need to find evidence that the product design is robust. In other words, it is insensitive to variation in environment and usage. It is designed to challenge the system under stress conditions. So if you're in a rush in the blood bank, there's a lot of pressure from the operating room. There are many cross-matching procedures that are going on at the same time. You need to be able to have peak performance even under these stress conditions. So you also need to consider user skill level and potential problems. Operator errors are, of course, sometimes problematic. You need to be able to identify or recognize specimen integrity and handling errors. Labels are important, both patient labels, specimen labels, and how they correspond correctly. Reagent integrity is important as far as temperatures and storage conditions and transport conditions. There are key environmental factors, of course, including, as we mentioned, temperature, which is very critical for some of our blood bank procedures. And of course, because now we're doing many, many tests and our networking will involve several different places as part of our network, several different blood service facilities, we need to have also robust hardware, software, and integrity in our electronics. And finally, we need to be able to show stability of calibration. So obviously in the blood bank, our goal is really zero mistakes. Okay? The blood bank is one area in the laboratory where we strive to be perfect, nothing short of perfect. So the fewer mistakes or no mistakes is an ideal we hope to achieve. However, that's not always the case. We can only hope to minimize errors. One of the safest hospital procedures, which is anesthesia, as measured by related fatalities, is reported to operate at a Six Sigma level of 5 Sigma, which is equivalent to 233 defects per 1 million opportunities, which is rather a lot if you think of each one of these 233 as patients. But applying this same 5 Sigma defect statistic from the so-called safest hospital medical procedure to blood bank testing yields 5,359 possible testing errors for 200,000 specimens. And that is a bit frightening because many of our centers process more than 200,000 specimens, sometimes even 500,000 or so specimens. So we need to be very careful about minimizing errors. So again, is a test fit for purpose? Aside from analytical evidence, we need to have clinical evidence. So we look at combined information from clinical data and its evaluation. So the manufacturer must have evidence to support any clinical claims of sensitivity or specificity. And all performance claims must be supported by well-designed performance evaluations. The clinical evaluations should be an independent study. The details of at least one well-designed independent performance evaluation, and if the study has been published, to provide publication details. In practice, most of the time, if there are clinical claims by manufacturer, we ask for original studies and copies of these or reference citation of these so that we can check it out ourselves. Because you take note that testimonials are not considered evidence of performance. It's not enough to hear from other hospitals or laboratory staff or product users or patients vouching for these products. You have to make sure that these are performed in scientific studies, you know, favorably in robust studies. So testimonials really do not count. So there are many challenges in obtaining high quality tests. Again, we start with setting up common technical specifications for IVD evaluation. And as a guide, most of the time we rely on World Health Organization guidelines, but also guidelines from neighboring blood centers and authorities like Australia, New Zealand, Europe, European Council. Providing local quality and required variety of panel sera for evaluation is important. And here we may have some difficulty because of financial constraints. These panel sera, which detect seroconversion or low titer samples, are rather expensive to procure. We need to have adequate qualified personnel to run evaluation through training. And as I said, everyone who runs HIV testing in the blood bank setting or even in the diagnostic laboratory setting needs to be certified by the proper government agency, either the National Reference Lab for PTIs or the HIV laboratory in the Department of Health. Standardized testing kit evaluation protocols are followed. And as I said, certification of laboratory that run evaluations, which means that not just the laboratory personnel in the blood center, but also the National Reference Laboratory needs to be evaluated. And this is done in the Philippines through our connections with Canada. There is a quality assurance scheme in Canada to which we have subscribed. So finally, in the National Reference Laboratory testing, we see the prevalence according to region. And here, again, we point out on this map of Luzon that it is Central Luzon and the National Capital Region that has the darkest red areas. Just to show you a map of the Visayas, which is where Cebu is, famous, some of the famous resorts on this map, Cebu and Bohol. And here they rank, particularly Cebu, which is actually in the central Visayas, has a problem with HIV, usually related to intravenous drug use. And that is a particularly observed cluster around Cebu and the metropolitan areas. And finally, in this map of Mindanao, which is the southernmost group of islands in the Philippines, we see some dark red areas around Davao, also a metropolitan area. And also you will see some of the resorts, beach resorts, which are on this map. And in summary, about prevalence, you will see that our positive donations are in the range of 0.331% in total. And as far as HIV is concerned, 0.045% of our blood donations have been confirmed to be positive for HIV in 2020. We go back to this chart. Again, I think the most important take-home message in any particular lecture on blood safety and HIV is that we have to be aware of the threats that are borne by either a window PO donation or an eclipse PO donation, which is on this map as highlighted, up to 10 days after exposure to HIV, it is not possible to detect the presence of HIV, even with nucleic acid tests. For serologic tests, it's P24 antigen that performs best and reduces your window period to roughly 15 to 20 or 2 to 3 weeks. And for the usual ELISA or antibody tests, including chemiluminescence, this is usually up to 2 to 3 weeks in reduction of window periods. I guess the most important message here is that it is not enough to just test our blood units to render them safe. It is very important to know the quality of our blood donors, to have strict donor interviews, because there are donors who may or may not be safe, and you cannot have a full 100% guarantee even with your NAT testing, that your donor is free of HIV. So I'd like to acknowledge the help of the TTINRL, the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine of the Philippines, particularly CANTH, and the Technical Committee of the DOH, National Council for Blood Services. So thank you. And remember, safe blood starts with me. And that involves all of us, without exception. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nuqui, for the amazing presentation with a lot of information about the guidelines and her own experiences for HIV screening. And let's move on to the last session. In this session, you will have half an hour to ask your questions to our speakers directly through your microphones. If you want to get the certificate of this webinar, please scan this QR code and take a few minutes to complete the questionnaire. We would like you to provide your feedback. Any comments and suggestions from you will be valued. That will help us better understand how to improve our webinars in the future. Thank you so much. Any questions? No questions? Yeah, actually, we collected some questions.
Sure. Actually, here we collected some questions. Yes, the first is come to Dr. Sian. For detecting, Dr. Sian, are you here?
Yes, Dr. Tina.
Yes, the first question is that for detecting mutants, what advantages can chemiluminescence immune assay provide compared with the rapid test and ELISA? This is the first question.
The test depends on how it can detect the mutant, what antibody it used to detect the antigen. But the sensitivity, it is different between the sensitivity capability and the mutant detection capability. So if you want to detect the mutant, then you should have the antibody that can detect the mutant. You should have not just one antibody, maybe more antibody that can detect this different point of the antigen. So different assay have different mutant detection capability. For the chemiluminescent ELISA and rapid diagnostic test, usually as we found, as I mentioned in the 70 kit studied by Schaubauer, it found that the rapid diagnostic test has lowest sensitivity. It has the sensitivity between 0.1 to more than 4 IU per ml. And the chemiluminescence has more sensitivity because of its method. And nowadays, I think there are many chemiluminescent assay that can detect less than 0.1, even to 0.01 or 0.205 IU per ml. Is that answering the question?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Dr. Sian. And here's another question. As we all know, there are 5 parameters for hepatitis B, like HBsAg, anti-HBs, HBeAg, etc., 5 parameters. Do you think for the treatment monitoring could benefit more from combined tests, like using this, combine these 5 parameters together, or just use one parameter, HBsAg? What's your suggestion on this?
Actually, for the diagnosing hepatitis B infection, is the combination of markers has the benefit because it can detect the mutants by combining the markers. But for the monitoring, it means that we know already the patient, but we have to know whether this has to be treated or not treated. This has the whether this after treatment, it the HBs antigen has already eliminated, or just because of the sensitivity of the HBs antigen, it cannot be detected. So maybe we should have the HBV DNA, and if the maybe we have to also monitor during, like I said, during certain periods, 6 months, to monitor also with the anti-HBe to monitor the seroconversion to know whether it already become seroconverted and show a good treatment response. Also, the quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen can help in in guiding the treatment in HBV patient, especially with the pegylated interferon alpha. It has the capacity to stop or continue the treatment.
Thank you, Dr. Sian, for your answer. That means still it's better to combine these five parameters together with also the HBV DNA test, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thank you, Dr. Sian. And I noticed in the chat box, there's another question from Dr. Nura. And can quantitative HBsAg examination replace HBV DNA examination to diagnose chronic hepatitis B?
There is no, as far as I know, as far as I read, there is no conclusion yet. There is still a study doing whether the hepatitis B surface antigen, quantitative hepatitis B surface antigen, can replace the HBV DNA. But it can help in places where there is no molecular testing available, because it correlates with the HBV DNA. For certain numbers, like very low HBV DNA, it's correlated with the less than 2000, something like that. It has been found in many studies.
Okay, got it. Dr. Nura, is there any question from you still? Okay, it seems that there's no problem for this question. Thank you, Dr. Sian. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome.
Yeah, there are three questions come to Dr. Nuqui. Dr. Nuqui, are you here? Hello, Dr. Nuqui. Dr. Nuqui, are you here? Are you still online? Hello, Dr. Nuqui. Are you here?
Hi, Dr. Nuqui.
Nuqui is still muted.
Yes.
Okay, Dr. Nuqui. Here we collected three questions for HIV management. The first one is that from we all know that false negative results are not acceptable for HIV. So it means sensitivity should be more important than specificity for HIV test, especially in blood bank. But why, in your presentation, you mentioned that the specificity is much higher than the sensitivity, like the specificity should be more than 99.8%, but sensitivity should be more than 99%. Might know the reason why the specificity is much higher than the sensitivity for the criteria for HIV test.
Hello?
Hello, yes, we can hear.
Oh, okay, because I couldn't unmute myself. I was trying to, it said the host had to do it. I'm sorry, okay. According to our WHO specifications, which we follow, we need 100% sensitivity. However, when there are evaluations based on what we call SACO, which is our one of our agencies for in vitro diagnostic reagents. They have considered even 99.5 or greater than 99.5%. But it is true that sensitivity has to be very close to 100%, if not 100%. And it's more important for blood screening to have a higher the highest sensitivity possible than it is for specificity, which is a diagnostic requirement to establish the presence of disease. So that is that comment is true. I'd like to correct also, if I may, on the graph that explains confirmatory test results for 2020, that the shades of maroon and dark and a dark maroon really misled me. In this graph, there is about one third, 33 to 40%, which are confirmed positive for HIV. And the one that goes up to 95% is actually including the bar for negatives. In other words, they were not confirmed on the reactive sample. I just wanted to correct that in my discussion.
Got it, Dr. Nuqui. So that still means sensitivity should be more important than specificity, right?
Yes, yes, definitely. Yes.
Okay. Even in SACO, so the sensitivity should be more than sensitivity. Sensitivity should be more than specificity.
Correct. In SACO. Okay. We do have the unique condition where we have the SACO being the reference for diagnostic HIV testing, and we have the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine, which is a national reference lab for blood services or TTIs. This is where the difference is. Of course, in the AIDS program of the Department of Health, they only, in fact, require rapid testing to establish diagnosis. And of course, in the blood program, that is not acceptable because we definitely need more sensitive tests. But in practicality, because of their eagerness to connect or to link our patients to treatment, to ART, and their goal is now like 95% of those who know their status should immediately be linked to antiretroviral treatment. That is why they have now used as a policy rapid HIV diagnostic testing. That is completely different from the blood program, which is for screening for blood safety for the presence of transfusion transmissible infections. And for that, we do need 100% sensitivity. In other words, we cannot afford to let escape or render safe a possible blood unit that is in fact not safe, or that is tainted by HIV. I hope that clarifies the situation.
Of course, got it, Dr. Nuqui. It's much clearer now. So it still depends on the clinical application scenario for the HIV test. It's for screening test or it's for the diagnosis.
Right, correct.
Okay. The second question is that you just mentioned for the whole test system for a good blood screening assay. So what features do you think a good HIV test assay should have, and what services the manufacturer should provide for users?
As I explained, ideally it should follow all the specifications for transmission-transmissible infections, the screening for tests, including HIV, but also it should be robust, supported by clinical evidence, like scientific studies on donors, at least having been tested on at least 5,000 donors, and exhibiting the limit of detection to be able to detect even low titers, you know, so that in the period of seroconversion from non-reactive to reactive, it's able to detect that. That is important.
So you still think the performance is the first priority for the samples, the seroconversion panels?
Yes. Seroconversion panels are very important for blood bankers to pay attention to. The situation of product certification in our country is that the kit is evaluated first. There is a representative kit of, say, 100 tests are submitted to our authorizing agency, which is the Food and Drug Administration, and that is evaluated. Mm-hmm. And it can, if it passes the requirements of performance, then it is given a product certification. Unfortunately, this is subject to a lot of variability, and the actual performance in the field is may or may not be representative of what they find on the initial evaluation. That's why it's very important to participate in the quality assurance survey that we conduct out of our ITM. This is what we call the NEQAS, because that is the only way we can monitor the field performance of these reagent kits and platforms when they're actually out in the field screening our blood donors. It's not enough to rely on the initial product certification. We have to understand and monitor how they actually perform in the field on our donors through all the blood service facilities that are using these various reagents and platforms.
Pre and full evaluation first.
Yes, true.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui, for your answers. Yeah, these are all the questions collected from our chat box previously. Is there still any other questions?
Thank you,
Dr. Nuqui. Thank you, Dr. Sian.
May I ask a question about hepatitis?
Sure, of course.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm very interested in hepatitis, hepatitis B in particular, because more than HIV, hepatitis B is for one, very prevalent among Filipinos. And number two, we do have a lot of occult B infections and mutations. We're not really confident that we're picking all of them up. So I was wondering what would be the best strategy for our country where there are a lot of occult B infections, there are likely a lot of hepatitis B mutations. I may ask Dr. C on that piece of advice, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui. It is a privilege for me to answer this. Actually, first we have, if it's possible, we have to know the mutation variety in our countries. And then if we cannot have it, then we should choose our kits, whether they have more variant detection capability, because they should be able, like you said, when we are choosing the instrument or method, they have to provide us with the capability of detecting the mutant. And then next, if we are suspecting of there is a mutant, like we have HBs antigen negative with anti HB core positive or something like that, and then we can do retesting maybe with the other platform, which maybe more I have more capability in detecting the mutant, or we can have use the HBV DNA to make sure that to do the determination of the HBV infection. Actually, in the mutant, have the combination of serological marker will be beneficial in early detection.
Right. May I ask if you, in fact, use hepatitis B core in your blood screening, because the recommendation of WHO for hepatitis B is just hepatitis B surface antigen. Do you actually use or employ HBC or anti-HB core in your blood program?
Yeah, the blood bag or the blood testing is done for, by the Red Cross in Indonesia, and not I'm looking in the clinical laboratory, so I'm not testing the blood, the donor blood. But as far as I know, it was tested by tested with the HBs antigen, and also it also and the other marker for HIV, HCV, and also the syphilis marker and malaria also in the certain region. But it will be also in Jakarta. It will be also tested with the NAT.
Right.
Yeah. But in other in other province, maybe they don't have the privilege of having of also testing the negative blood with the NAT, nucleic acid testing.
Right. Okay. Thank you. It's probably the same. The same is true of metropolitan areas in the Philippines. There are now about 40 facilities that in fact do nucleic acid testing all over the country. All the blood centers in the major metropolitan areas conduct screening using nucleic acid testing now, precisely because we're worried about hepatitis B and occult B infections.
Yeah.
So thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sian.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui. Thank you, Dr. Sian. Any questions? Okay, no more questions. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you again for all the presentations and brilliant discussion, doctors. And thank you everyone joining us online for raising your questions. If you have additional questions, please feel free to send us by email, and the email address are listed at the bottom of this slide. And at last, don't forget to scan the QR code. Otherwise, you will not get the certificate. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you, Dr. Sian.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui.
Thank you,
Dr. Tina.
Thank you, Dr. Sian. Thank you, Jenny.
Thank you, Dr. Nuqui. Thank you, Dr. Sun.
Thank you, Tim.
Hello, everyone. Could you please turn on your camera and we just take a picture together?
Thank you all.
Did I turn it on? I guess I did.
Yeah, turn.
Okay.